Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Danley Sound Labs Fireside Chats. I'm Josh Millward, product specialist at Danley Sound Labs. And I'm going to be your host for this series. Please be sure to keep your mic muted and camera off to help conserve bandwidth for those who are on slow connections. This week, Chad Edwardson is the director of engineering at Danley Sound Labs, will be joining us. He'll be talking with us about system design, the good, the bad, and the ugly. After Chad's presentation, we will be taking questions and talking about them. Please use the chat feature at any time to send me your questions. I'll ask the questions to Chad when we get to that part of the presentation. Before we get started, I just want to take a minute to remind everyone that the Fireside Chat series happens every week with a different topic each week. Next week, Ivan Beaver will be joining us again. Ivan will be talking about interpreting spec sheets. There's often a lot of information on spec sheets, but sometimes the claims seem a little optimistic. Ivan is going to chat with us about how to spot when the numbers on the spec sheets just don't quite add up. So with that, let's go ahead and get started here. We'll have Chad go ahead and take it away.
All right. Hey, everybody. How you doing? Like Josh said, I'm Chad Edwardson with Danley Sound Labs. Really thank you for all attending today's chat. And as Josh mentioned, please use the chat feature throughout the presentation, and your questions will make it to Josh, and he will organize those, find duplicates, and pass those questions over to myself. Let's see here. So, all right, as Josh said, today we're going to be talking about system design and modeling, kind of in general. And I titled it the good, the bad, and the ugly. Not for any reason anything's too bad or ugly, but you know, there are some things that you know, that we do need to be aware of in the designing process, that we just have to use logic, right? We have to use our experience of previous jobs that we've done, and we have to use logic because the model's not going to give us necessarily all of the answers. So the good, the bad, the ugly. And I know the audio over GoToMeeting with the gates and everything is probably questionable, but I thought I would lighten up the day a little bit for y'all. And again, I hope everybody is safe and healthy today. That's what we all hope for, and we want to get through this thing as quick as possible. So again, today's topic, we're going to cover things that may not be considered when designing a sound system. It's important to understand what a model does and does not account for in its prediction. You know, I myself personally, we do, you know, obviously several hundred of models a year through the company. Previously worked in contracting, so we did a lot of different things through modeling and drawing on paper and that sort of thing. So for me, and I think for all of you, I would suggest that a model is just to reaffirm what you already believe to be the best solution, okay? So you've already, I mean, we've been in the business. We can walk into a room today and we can look around and we could say it needs vanilla, or it needs chocolate, or it needs strawberry, right? I mean, you have an idea of already what is needed for that, okay? But the model is great because it takes us beyond, you know, just our minds, and it helps us reaffirm that solution. So again, this means that you already have an idea of the outcome before you've even modeled it, right? You're just testing a theory, okay? I got an analogy. If I'm in math class in elementary school and I punch in my calculator 7 times 7, and the calculator says 4,000. I know
that I've done something wrong or the calculator is misfunctioning. We know right off the bat, you know, if it says 50 and I don't know what 7 times 7 is, I might know it's close, but it is close, right? So we have an approximation of what we're looking for before we're looking, okay, or before we're calculating. So, you know, the big thing is, how do we know if the model is correct?
You may be right. I may be crazy. Oh, but it just may be a lunatic you're looking for.
I thought that was a fitting song because in the audio business, we are all lunatics, okay? So let's look at the purpose of modeling, okay? These are just some things. I'm sure we could come up with a list of several, but you know, I've wrote down a few things that I think are important, okay? So what do we model for? First of all, we want a prediction of the system design. So we want to look at, we want it to help us obviously affirm what we believe needs to go in there, okay? And we may make some adjustments or see some things. Oh, okay, I didn't realize that was going to happen. And we may change things and that sort of thing, right? So then we're also, it's going to assist us in product selection. We look at how loud does the speaker need to be, right? Is it a spoken word situation? Is it a live band? You know, our distance is great. You know, how loud does the product need to be? What coverage does the product need to be? Okay, we can try in the model, we can try some different coverage, narrow product. We can try some wider product and just see how that covers the space. We can also define the locations of the devices. And that is important for a number of things. In the model, if we're doing detailed models where we're actually importing SketchUp or wireframes, we can look at, does the product actually fit? Does it have some sightline issues, so size? And we can look at if those locations are defined already, maybe they're going in the place of an old product and we have to hang from these positions on the ceiling. We can look at what that does from those positions. The other thing is when the project is underway, your contractors your installers have information on location, height, pitch, you know, pitch and yaw, and that can be very helpful. And this last one I think is actually in my list is probably on top, and I really think that models are powerful for the sales side of things. If you can increase your client's confidence, they're going to pick you. Okay. We live in a day that, you know, a lot of manufacturers have modeling software. Okay. And you have third party modeling software as well. But, you know, if you want to be able to bring a model to the table when you submit a design, it's powerful because one, you may have someone else that doesn't, or if they do, your model's going to look better, okay? You're going to be able to explain to the customer why your solution is superior, okay, through a design, through a model, okay? Okay, so we're going to move on to, we're going to start getting into just a few things that I selected that tend to, I'll say come up, not super frequent, but some things that I think some people need a refresher on or maybe don't know. Maybe they're looking at it from a different vantage point and aren't seeing what to consider, okay? So the first one's real simple. We are looking at aiming the loudspeaker, okay? You know, I can remember the days of, you know, not modeling and using pen and paper and a protractor, okay? You know, I'm sure we've all done it, right? And I can remember, I can actually remember being in eighth grade and being in class and bored and drawing what now I know to be stage plots. Didn't know back then, but I was drawing where all of our band equipment was going to be on the stage and how the lights were going to cover the stage and how the small PA system I had was going to cover the audience at our upcoming school dance. I had no idea what I was doing. I had read somewhere that the speaker had a given pattern, you know, a pattern. Now, I didn't know that the little bitty horn that was in that speaker was probably losing pattern at, you know, 4 or 8K or something like that. And it didn't matter. But the impression on me was, oh, I've got this pattern. It's like shining light into the room. So I would draw, you know, these little triangles from the speakers and cross them and, you know, didn't know exactly what was going on. But that led to, you know, later on when you start looking at flying speakers and looking at front to back coverage, you're trying to use the entire horn. Okay. And, you know, many of us know that that is not always the, in most cases, is not the the proper way to do it. But, you know, at some point in our careers, we've probably done it. You know, I say, if you have soldered any number of XLRs in your life and you say that you've never forgot to put the boot on before you soldered the connector, you're a liar, or you haven't done enough of them. If you have tweaked the EQ on the adjacent channel to what you intended to and you swore you heard a difference and you say you didn't do that, you're probably a liar, okay? And or you haven't mixed enough. So, I mean, these are things that, you know, we all come from something. We all come from not knowing, okay? So, you know, just understand that everyone's at a different position in their learning curve of life. And, yeah, so we learn these simple things. Aiming the loudspeaker, okay? So if we actually look at what radiates from the speaker, it's a lot more complicated than that triangle that I drew, okay? If you look at these two balloons here, they're two different products. Okay, so I want to make sure I point that out, that they're not that varied in coverage of coverage per frequency. So the one on the left is a 90 by 60 product, and the one on the right is a 25 by 25 product. And this shows, you know, how complex. You know, you can see all the little bumps and warts and things. And I mean, these are very well-behaved, good-looking balloons. I mean, you can pull up some balloons of some products out there, and I mean, it looks like crazy stuff, like, you know, stuff out of a Dr. Seuss book. But, you know, it is, the point here is to show you that they are not necessarily just that that triangle shape that we can draw with our protractor, okay? But the saving grace nowadays is we have all of these free, or a lot of times they're free, softwares that can do these predictions for us, right? And they're taking that complex shape of the balloon and they are doing the math to apply that across a flat plane, okay? Which is really amazing. And if we look at, you know, early days of direct modeling, or direct coverage modeling, you know, a lot of it was 2D stuff and, you know, a lot of the early ease focus stuff, right, was just like this. And this is great, too. I mean, it's a step up from the protractor because it allows you to see how that complex, a slice of that complex balloon intersects into an audience plane. OK, so we can get a kind of an idea of level as we go front to back. Now, what's great is we can add in this third dimension and we can really see what that balloon does on the audience plane itself, right? I mean, that that paints a bit of a different picture, especially as you get out further left and right, than what you could decipher from that single slice in the vertical. So, you know, this makes it extremely powerful. This is an image, I think it's shown up, something like this has shown up in all the Fireside chats, but, you know, it's very important. It's been in several books, you know, over the years. And the great thing about the synergy horn, and Mike and Tom brought this up last week, is this behavior really only works well in a product like the synergy horn because you have full, it's a full bandwidth horn. So we don't have a high frequency horn with a you know, a different horn size than the mid and the, and so on, and their offset drivers, because we have the synergy horn and everything's loading into that single horn. we really do get that constant directivity, okay, performance. So, you know, I have here, you know, let the horn do the magic. The edge of the horn will attenuate the level from front to back to give you even coverage, which is great. All right, somebody's got their microphone on. Mike?
Oh, I shouldn't be on. Sorry.
That's all right. Ladies and gentlemen, the owner of Danley Sound Labs.
Yeah, who doesn't know how to use a frickin' computer?
Well, thanks for showing up.
I'm going to turn this off.
All right. So we continue on. So, you know, our goal is even coverage, right? The next excerpt is going to be, let's look at some fill speakers, okay? Because, you know, Mike showed last week, he showed a great representation of a SM100 that covered a room really well, okay? And there's no doubt, there's plenty of examples of 100s or you know, definitely wider pattern speakers that we sell that can do a fine job of that, okay? But I would say that the norm is, you know, a little more oddly shaped spaces, and we tend to have to kind of cover things in zones in a lot of cases, right? So we want to be able to attenuate or delay a certain area, so we have to do that with more than one device, right? So, you know, the reality of it is, you know, Ivan always refers to there's trade-offs, right? And I, you know, we live in a world of trade-offs in life and speaker design, okay? So yes, a single speaker is ideal, and in some cases covers a space by itself. Many times we are dealing with odd shaped rooms, and the ability to control the coverage in zones is the better solution. We must still minimize the interaction between these devices, and we do that with high pass filters, delay, and level, okay? So if we're going to explore just an example of the same room, but with, you know, two different approaches, and let's talk about, you know, some of the things that, again, that the model may not be telling us so much, but we have to be educated and experienced enough to know what decisions to make. Okay, so this is a room that has a balcony. It's about 80 foot to the back wall of the balcony. And we've got a wide 96 on top and a 95 on bottom, okay? And, you know, if I look at this, I mean, front to back coverage is really good, okay? So, you know, I would say that this would work well. The one thing that I need to consider, though, in this model is, what are the acoustics of the space? What am I picking a fight with? Okay. So if I get back the design documents, or I get information from you, and you say, oh man, the room is like a dream. It's dead. It's great for sound reinforcement, and we don't have to worry about any, you know, major reflections. The back wall is treated really well, or it's very diffusive and it's done right. Okay. So that's great. And I would move forward with this design. But if things I have to consider is, okay, that back wall is 80 feet away, and let's say it's just a sheetrock wall, okay? There's no absorption in there. The acoustics in the space are not real great. That reflective path, and of course, there's gonna be several reflective paths, but I'm using this as the example, is going to reach the stage 160 feet later from when it left the speaker. So, we need to pay attention to the path traveled to the reflective back wall and understand that the reflection will be a continuation of the inverse square from the source. Okay. The reflection, you know, it by math, it's going to be roughly 6 dB down from the reflection point. And by the time it gets to the stage, where the stage is actually lower in level than the audience, right? Because that's our purpose. You know, it very well could influence the intelligibility, and in a lot of cases it can. I mean, you have the snare drum, right? The percussive, impulse of the snare, and you hear it, you know, in this case, 140, 150 milliseconds later, and it can be annoying, right? In speech, it can cause the person speaking to hear that and wonder what's going on, and it's going to affect intelligibility. Okay, so if we take another approach to this space, we can look at taking the same speakers, and all we do is we move that downfill out to the balcony, and we take a main cabinet and we aim it down more into the space, so its job is actually to cover the floor, and the balcony is to be covered by this same fill speaker. Okay, I know that, you know, in some cases this could be maybe a little more labor, a little more cable, but the outcome of the solution is going to be much better, mainly because we're moving that source that is really going to be glancing off that wall, we're moving it much closer, okay, so we can run the level much lower. And if you look at this, we're putting about the same amount of energy on the wall, really, but there's two things going on. One, our angle of incidence is going to be much steeper, and it's going to drive that energy into a very short reflection into the people in the balcony, which will actually be, it'll bring the SPL up, okay? And we're going to be very early in inverse square. We're 25 feet versus that 80 feet. So, you know, doublings, right? So if we're doubling that, we're going to be losing level, 6 dB per doubling, we're going to be losing level, fairly quickly, okay? So those are all positive things, okay? So what if we look at positive reflections? And no, this is not looking in the mirror and saying good things about yourself, okay? This is positive reflections from the standpoint of boundaries that are close to the listener, okay? So this is just another thing that the model is not necessarily going to show you, but understand that in real life, you will get better results than the model, okay? It's always good to go, you're going to get better, right? The model's conservative. So these walls, I mean, if you're staying, you know, if you want to call it whatever, 20 milliseconds or less of time from direct to reflective, that those are going to bring those levels up, okay? Back walls, back corners, okay, down there in the right corner, those are going to be, you know, huge influences on how that level comes up. But I will point out, don't be tricked by the model also when you're thinking that way. This front left corner, or I guess it'd be the right, well, however you want to look at it, but the left on the image in the red circle, this area is down because it's actually out of the coverage, okay? So although you will, you know, obviously have some gain against that wall of stuff that does get over there, it's not going to be full frequency, mainly the highs. So this really requires an outer fill or something to cover that area directly, okay? Okay, so kind of we're going to finish this up and then go to questions, but I want to touch on time of flight and distance to listener, and I've teamed these up because they tend to fall in the same projects, okay? These tend to be, venues with large distance. That could be, it could be your local high school football stadium with OS product way up on some poles or on the roof of the press box. And you just have to be careful. It's one thing to keep everything on that press box and kind of aim it out from that central location, right? Like a cluster, but be careful when you start putting, okay, well, hey, they happen to have a convenient light pole down here on the 15 yard line and one on the other end. And, you know, we've got 200 feet, 200 something feet between them, and we're trying to aim them in and across the field. And like, just have to be careful because, although in these smaller rooms, we don't deal with reflections or we'll call late arrivals of great, great magnitude. I mean, we can, but these spaces really, really show what the problem is, okay, with time of flight. And so we just have to be considerate of that. And here's an example. I mean, all these stadiums are about the same. Believe it or not, they're all based around the same size field in the middle. But, you know, here's this is Tiger Stadium. Excuse me. And, you know, it has, just like any of them, has some great distances to cover. And we're covering it from the scoreboard. So when we start looking at those distances, I mean, you know, you really start reaching out there to people, okay? And we have to be, one, mindful of the level that it needs to be at those people. And the other thing is we have to look at, okay, what are we aiming this into, okay? So several of these stadiums can be fairly diffusive because the surfaces are not tremendously large. But some of them are, I mean, they're just big sides of buildings, or they've got the suites and everything, and they're, you know, 5-6 stories tall, and it's just a big reflective glass wall. And you try to do your best to keep energy, you know, where it needs to be, right? So in situations like this, we use our large Jericho products to achieve even coverage. And I just say that even outdoors, that we must pay attention to reflections, because distances are great, okay? And all of that stuff, even though it's outdoors, will play into what the intelligibility is, okay? Now, if we move indoors and we look at a space like a typical arena, you know, of course, in a model, I could build this arena and I could probably put a couple of Jerichos up in one of the corners and just about cover the whole place. I mean, it's covering it. I mean, an example, we were at Lambeau Field and we were doing the commissioning. The system was muted and they were playing music and we're going, we can still hear it. And we're like, I mean, it's far away, wherever it's coming from, and we're going, what on earth is that? And believe it or not, there were some SH micros that were not muted over in an area. And, by terms, they were covering the stadium. I mean, we were about as far away as you could get from them, and we could still hear them. Luckily, settings and everything were right on them, because to be playing at that level that we could hear them, they still were still fine and they worked just fine. So, but you know, it's one thing to cover something, but it's another thing, again, going back to use logic, okay? I find in these arenas too, where the, you know, either we want to be creative or we want to save budget, and what they'll do is they'll actually put the Jericho product in or something like that, and they try to tuck it in the scoreboard in the middle of the room and just cover the room, and you can make a model look exceptionally good, okay? But you know, it's nothing beats in these spaces, because these venues, I have not been in one of these venues that acoustically is great, okay? So these indoor venues just they don't behave well acoustically, okay? There's too much volume in them. And if we have to pull that speaker back, turn it up twice as loud, and try to cover the people, you know, we're really we're already hamstrung with the acoustics of the space, and now we're just picking a fight with it. So we tend to find that the model of bringing the speakers closer to the people is your best solution. And you can see in this representation of this space, you know, actually this room has something similar to this. It has a lower bowl coverage and an upper bowl coverage, and we try to get those speakers as close to the people as possible. I mean, we are the kings of making big horns, and you know, big spaces just need big horns, and you know, it doesn't hurt. It's never a bad thing to get the speaker even closer and closer to the people, because your intelligibility will just continue to rise in those spaces, okay? Okay, so that's what I've got for you today. Hopefully you guys have sent Josh some questions. And, you know, again, I hope that this helps you become more comfortable with system design And remember that we are here to support you. My email is chad@danleysoundlabs.com. And you can always email me. You can reach out to your sales representation, and they should have a design request guidelines, and it'll give you a list of things that we would love to see, photos, videos, drawings, answer a few questions, and we will help you. And we are always inspiring people to, you know, jump in there and do your own designs. If you just, if you want to try it, which many of you do, and you just want to send them to us to review, that's fine too. We can do that very quickly and give you guys some pointers. But so Josh, I think I'm ready to turn it back over to you, and let's hear what we have question wise.
All right. That sounds good. The so Ivan just popped in here with a good question about how much detail should be included in a model.
Well, it goes back to the software you're using, right? So if it's direct coverage, not much. but he's referring to software that utilizes the acoustic portion or the acoustic package. And you know, the idea is you should model down to at least the half wavelength of the highest frequency. And you know, if you look at that, that can get to be really small. So I mean, is your model including door handles and baseboard and, you know, all sorts of little things that you could think of? Probably not. So again, it goes back to you know, have a good idea of what the model should be telling you before you jump on the model is, you know, answering all your questions. So yes, to his point, in that kind of modeling, you ultimately do need to model down to a small size.
Right. Yeah. If you're expecting to get any detailed information out of the package acoustically wise, you certainly need to be modeling the bits and pieces that actually affect the acoustics and not just the direct coverage areas.
That's correct.
So Kyle asked an interesting question, and I had to ask him for a little clarification on it, because I'll have to admit I've not read Bob McCarthy's book. But specifically, Kyle was asking, do you work to Bob McCarthy's idea of forward aspect ratio? And I guess I wasn't too sure exactly what he was asking, so I asked for a little bit of information about that. And he went on to clarify that apparently Bob has a mathematical formula that you can use to measure the width and the depth of the room, and you plug the numbers into this this formula, and it basically says you need a horn that's X number of degrees wide to cover this area. And like I said, I'm not familiar with Bob's book exactly, so I wasn't just sure how that worked, but Kyle put the formula and whatnot here in the chat, and a link to an article about the forward aspect ratio. Chad, are you familiar with that at all, or do you use that at all?
No, I don't use it, and I will say that I'm not familiar with it. I understand what you're describing, and I don't know how many books Bob has. I do have one of his books, and I could go back, or better yet, I'll just if you want to forward me that link, I'll look into that afterwards. But from what you're describing, I mean, I could understand how you could mathematically look at you know, again, we'd be going back to more straight line. You have to make some assumptions that it's a straight line protractor type of angle. But yeah, I mean, you could definitely do that. So I'd love to look into that, Kyle. Thank you. I personally have not read that.
Okay, I'll be sure to, Chad, I'll be sure to get you the link that he shared with us. I've got it open in a web browser right now, so I'll forward that to you later so you can see it. So Mike suggested here, tell them how we got rivers of light with using Danley Direct.
Okay. So Rivers of Light is a show that opened, has it been 3 years ago now, maybe? At Animal Kingdom down in Orlando. And it is a production that takes place on the big lake there towards the back of the park. And it's at night. And they have all of these, computerized GPS guided boats and light shows and all sorts of events. But I think what Mike is referring to is the big issue with sound in Animal Kingdom, especially in the evening, is there's animals, right? And honestly, the animals are the highest priority for them in that park. And you know, and rightfully so, right? They're animals, and they need to have as much of a normal life as they can have in that environment. So we had all of these folks that were there on behalf of the monkeys, because that was the closest exhibit to the House Wright setup, and they were walking around with all these little plastic handheld SPL meters, and here we are, we're gonna go out and do this demo. But the big thing that Direct allowed us to do was to show them, they were scrambling to find out how could they have an array right across the walking path from the monkey exhibit that wouldn't put sound and disturb the monkeys in their time of rest and eating. So through Direct, we were able to import that Google Maps and scale it. Like I showed a number of weeks ago on the last online deal we did. And we were able to show, because obviously, with a horn, there's J364s, and they have great forward directivity, right? They're still a pretty good size horn, so they were no problem. It's the bass, right? I mean, the bass becomes so omni. So not only did we use the BC415 that has forward directivity on its own, but we did it in the cardioid bass array. And I mean, the levels were significantly down in the rear. And I mean, it passed with flying colors. I mean, it showed it in the model, which got us the opportunity to do this demo, which, I mean, you're talking about when they do a demo like this, it is a mock-up. And I mean, it's everything and everybody is involved. And I mean, it was absolutely crazy. But all night work, because they obviously have the parks going during the day. Well, except for now. But the ability to show them that, get to, do the demo, and then the demo proves the model right. And yeah, and we got the job. And it's a successful project. The folks that were concerned with the monkeys were definitely not concerned with the show. So they had no reason. They had every reason to say no. And no, I mean, it passed. So that was a great example. I appreciate you pointing that out, Mike.
So in a related note, well, there's a couple of related things here. Ian just posted that he likes to use Direct as a sales tool function to show people the SPL in various locations using microphones in Direct. And apparently that has been extremely useful for him and his sales things.
Yeah, and I think that's great, because I truly believe, although I'm, on this side of the engineering side, we're all salespeople, right? I mean, I know internally in the company, that's our motto, as far as, we're always there to help the customer make the right decision. But my background, I was a sales guy at one point. And I look at this, I mean, some of the things that that came to me after coming to Danley for a number of years was, if I could go back into sales like I was before, it would be models and demos. I think those are the most powerful tools that you have. I mean, obviously relationships, yeah. but models and demos are huge. And I didn't do enough of them back in the day. And, yeah. You know, so I appreciate
agree with
that,
you completely on that.
I agree.
It's and always. The great thing,
oh, go ahead.
Oh, it's always a powerful thing when you can set up a product in front of someone and show them what it'll actually do. Because, you know, there's so many people who talk so much and, oh, you know, our stuff's the best stuff. And, you know, everybody who's selling anything is always selling the best of whatever, right?
Sure.
So when you can set it up and say, all right, here, listen to this. And even better, being able to do a side-by-side comparison is great.
Oh yeah, 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 and to Ian's point, the ability, I mean, the software is really, I mean, it's easy enough to, you can meet someone at a job or a demo, and they, let's say, okay, I like that. So what would you do in our space? Well, a lot of us would say, well, I'll get back to you in a couple of days, and da da da. You can open up your laptop, you can say, okay, this is about 50x80. Or it's 100x200, whatever the space is, and you can drop a speaker in there, turn a speaker on, and put it in position in a matter of minutes, and at least it gives them something. Yes, it may not be every feature and angle and piece of information you need to go do the install, but capture that customer in the moment, and you know, they'll be impressed just by the fact that you opened up the software and did the work. So
right. Yeah. So going back to doing the low frequency modeling there with Direct for the Rivers of Light thing, Kim mentioned here to please discuss low end placement and how modeling can show the difference in central located subs versus distributed subs. Also discuss the technique of flying subs.
Okay. So there are some things that obviously the model will show you, which if we turn the phase feature on in Direct, we can look at, that's the only way to really look at that interaction. Otherwise it's pure summation. So if we turn on the phase and we look at two devices that are close enough within a quarter wavelength of the highest frequency, then we know that we've got summation, though it behave as a single device, just louder. Okay. So that's great in the central location. If that centrally located subs are flown in a software that takes into just direct coverage, it's going to show you that level, even with phase on, it's going to show you that summed level, and it's going to move it. It's going to change the ratio of closest listener to furthest listener in most cases. So it's going to be more even looking, okay? The one thing, though, going back to my presentation of what does it and does it not tell you, if you're flying those subs, okay, there's again trade-offs. Your alignment to the mains, especially if they're in the center, are going to be much better, much more averaged. Okay, so that's a good thing. The distance from closest to furthest listener is going to be a lot better. Okay, so that's a good thing. But the one thing that just keep in mind is that floor is a boundary. It's a reflective surface. So imagine that there is an identical room inversed underneath the building. So if I'm flying that sub, 30 feet off the ground in the middle of the room, there's a sub 30 feet below the ground in the other room. And, in that theory, that sub is just like it's a split sub, okay? And on a floor, you're actually in the power alley, okay? So that's fine. Where it can be, and I'll just point this out, and it's not an end all to do it. This doesn't make up my mind, but you can possibly see some anomalies in a raised seating area, like a balcony, okay? Where if we go to split subs on the ground, we're going to have the power alley, and then depending on the frequency, we're going to have, lobes going out from that, okay? And that'll all be frequency dependent and spacing. But imagine that in the vertical. Okay. So now we've got Power Alley on the ground. Everyone's happy, but we could have a null or something up above that, right? We've just turned that 90 degrees, that panel. So, you know, it's these are all great solutions for different designs. We tend to do a lot of flown subs for auditoriums and such, because it gets the speakers out of the way. It ultimately gets you better even coverage front to back because of the ratio of closest to furthest listener. But if I'm doing a concert, you know, whatever, rock concert, EDM, whatever, I'm not going to necessarily get hung up on the flown, or maybe it's some type of combination, which again, you got to be careful there, because of now you're just adding interaction in the vertical as well as in the horizontal, and there can be some things that go on. Large venues, you know, centrally located, unless you got a really high ceiling, don't also work often because you know, closest listener to furthest listener is way off. If I've got a huge space, I've either got to get those subs way up, like in an arena where we do have, you know, 80 to 100 foot of trim height to fly, and we can get that ratio of listeners in a very good average. But if I'm in a space where I've got a lower ceiling, 30 foot, and I've got, you know, great distances to cover left, right, and going out front, then, you know, maybe my better solution is a whole bunch of subs, okay? Maybe it's something that is subs along the front of the stage that, you know, I can do maybe a little bit of control with as far as like a base array, that sort of thing. But yeah, I mean, it's interesting, and that's what makes the tool so great, is you can play out these scenarios. And I know Kyle and Ian do a lot of that in their markets.
Right. The key, though, to looking at a lot of that stuff is you do have to turn on the phase toggle in direct to be able to see that interaction between the devices, right?
That is correct. Yep. Yep. And, you know, you run into people wanting to do directional bass, and they want to stuff this stuff under the front of the stage. And, you know, that's another not accounted for in a lot of softwares, right? So, you know, understand that some of that stuff falls apart when you get into different either tune spaces or reflective spaces. So, you know, it's just all stuff to know that you can make it look great in the model, but it doesn't mean that it's going to perform that way in reality.
Right. Yeah. In the chat over here, Mike had mentioned that with the Rivers of Light thing in direct, they had, I don't know who did the model exactly, but whomever did, had taken a Google Earth picture of the area where that was going to be, which showed where the monkey cages were, and yeah. And thus you were able to show what the SPL, the likely SPL, was going to be in those locations. Further, Cooper then also had sent a note talking about how indirect it is really handy that you can import pictures. So that can be a floor plan or a Google Earth image or something like that to overlay your audience planes on. So just in order to help you lay out where everything is.
I mentioned that that was something that was pointed out in the previous online class that I did for Direct, which was being able to import any type of image. I mean, you can, anything you can screen capture or bring in, you can, you know, crop down and bring into Direct and scale it. And it's a very useful tool.
Yeah. I love doing that myself when working on doing design things, because, you know, if someone can send you even a PDF of drawings of the space, being able to put that in there and then just overlay the audience planes on top of it makes for a very quick and easy way to lay things out and make it very easy to set up.
Absolutely.
So Kim also asked here about what frequencies, you know, when you're doing, when you're looking at coverage, you know, trying different loudspeakers in a model that you've put together, what frequencies do you start with to check out the to check out how well that loudspeaker may fit that application? Yeah.
Well, on full range product, anything that's going to have mids and highs, especially, I look at the what I believe is, you know, kind of the more critical bandwidth stuff. So I would say anywhere from about 2K to, you know, maybe up to 4K, kind of in that region. And I may bounce between the two and just kind of just make sure that things are correlating as you change. Of course, you can run coverage of the movie, and that can help you from a visual standpoint. But so on full range, yeah, that's where I'm at. And then subs, a lot of times I'll just go down and select 50 hertz just to kind of see where it's at. Most cases, in most jobs, we're not doing anything that's a lot of directional bass, but of course that we would want to dial into the tuned frequency of what we're trying to cancel and deal with in the cardioid spacing. But that's the kind of stuff I would look at, as well as the great thing about the microphones, back to Ian's point, is they paint a different picture, right? Or more of a picture. They you can place that, of course it's only in that one spot. But I'm not just looking at 4K either, right? I'm looking at, is there a notch at 3? And I'm not seeing that, or, you know, that sort of thing. So most of the time I'm going to be looking, if I'm really trying to dive in, I'm going to be looking at 1 octave wide on a full range in probably somewhere between 2 and 4K.
Right. So in the chat here, Ian mentions that 2K to... what, 63 hertz, Ian? So the basically low mid to mid band is where he starts. Bill Johnson then mentioned here that using the 2K 1 octave mapping in direct is where he typically starts. So
I would agree with that.
Sounds like that 2K area is kind of a popular spot for a lot of people to start with.
It's really where you want to put the boost. You know, if you've got 15 dB available at 2K, that's where you really want to put the boost, right?
I don't think I need quite 15 dB of 2K, but...
no, I'm joking.
But no, knowing you have it available can be handy.
yeah.
Let's see. Oh, Seth mentioned in here that in the systems that he's installed, he thinks that he has only installed one sub on the floor. And that was primarily because in that venue, the ceiling couldn't handle the weight of having the sub up above. But he loves the coverage from ceiling flown subs. And yeah. it works very well for him, apparently.
Yep. Yeah, and there is that... misnomer, if you want to call it that we always say, oh, I got to have them on the floor, you're giving up that coupling. But you can look at several ways, and the reality of it is either the sub has to be on the plane or you, the listener, has to be on the plane. And that's that whole point of, there's a sub down below earth that's there too, and you are in the power alley. So they can sometimes tend to give you the perception of, whatever, more impact, more level. What it is you're closer to the speaker. I mean, if I'm right, 10 feet from the speaker because it's under the stage versus it's 30 foot above me, right there. Right. I mean, there's some SPL, right? And but you are on the boundary, right? So,
right. Yeah. You personally are boundary loaded. So,
yeah.
So having the loudspeaker above is not really a big change.
Yep.
So Ian mentioned here, you don't want that 15 dB at 2K in Scotland, as it's all fiddles and accordions and bagpipes. which makes a 2K a bit of a battleground.
Oh, boy.
But then Ivan points out that 2K is the center of intelligibility for speech, hence the reason to look at it first, which is definitely good points.
I totally
definitely
agree.
Good points.
Sometimes I'll drift above that, maybe 4K, because I want to see it, you know, does the device start to, because the reality of it is, you are going to transition into some point, you're going to transition to where the directivity of the device is actually born in the device. The horn is do nothing, right? So, you know, at some point, of course, a lot of times it's way up there, it starts to get very narrow. But I think it's, you got to kind of look at a few things. If you only look at one, then you're only going to get one picture.
Right. Yeah. Here's another good question from Kim. He mentions, say you have a main speaker that goes down to 50 hertz. So it's a pretty full range loudspeaker on its own, though you're going to use it with a sub. Would it be okay to fly the sub further out in the audience area? If you're going to do that, how far in front could the sub be flown without being localized?
Okay, so there's a few things that play into that, and Ivan and I have talked about this a lot. Ivan introduced me to this whole concept years ago, and it does work. But Kim's point is, you know, a full range cabinet, which really is needed, okay? And because ultimately you want to run that low pass a bit lower than you might if it was flown right with the array, okay, where you're going to get that summation. So with the process of running that low pass, you know, sometimes down to, let's say, 60 hertz. So if I got mains that get me strong, down to 50, I may run that low pass down to 60 on the sub. And as far as how far you can put it out in the room, it really depends on the ceiling height. You know, this doesn't always work in, or it won't work in rooms that have low ceilings, right? Because we just can't get the speaker. Again, it's still about a closest to furthest listener. So you need to, ideally, you need to have a decent ceiling height. And, you know, we've done them where they're 20, 25 feet. 15 to 25 feet probably out in front of the main array. And again, that's with a really good ceiling height. By lowering that low pass, we start to, our localization starts to really, dwindle when the lower the frequency. So The idea is you don't delay that sub because it's still trying to cover the entire audience, and some of that audience is actually behind it or towards the stage. So we don't delay that, but we're dealing with wavelengths that are, you know, very long. So we're in that zone where we have, because of wavelength, we have quite a bit of, fudge factor, and we are a good ratio away from the people, and we're lower in frequency, so your localization, you know, doesn't tend to be as superb as it would be at 1K, right? So it's kind of like you've been outside and you hear a low rumble or an explosion or something, and it's really hard to figure out where the heck it came from. So hopefully that helps answer that.
Right. Okay. So I think that pretty well wraps up what we've got here for questions. If anyone else has any, I'd encourage you to plug them in pretty directly here. I guess we've made it around to the top of the hour. So if no one has anything else, let's see here. Oh. Kyle popped in here with one. Is it possible to date the data that's indirect for loudspeakers? It'd be nice to know if something's been updated recently when we do updates to that.
I'll talk to Sebastian about that and see how we could notate that. Maybe it's in a release notes, if anything. That's possible. But I'll see if there's a way in the software itself you know, maybe I don't know if he could, the font could be a different color. I don't know. We can look into what possibilities we have there.
Okay, and then Bill Johnson asked here if using the report tool in Direct, can a date be placed on that report?
A date that, so you have, when you look at the, I forget what the tab on the bottom is called, is it called Project? And you fill in the information, customer, and so on. There is a date on there that you can punch in, and it doesn't follow the today's date. You have to actually manually put it in. And when you save the file, it'll actually save that in there. But that'll show up on the report on the first page.
Oh, yeah. Bill just clarified that wasn't a question. He was simply noting that you can put a date on it. Okay. Sorry, Bill. I guess there wasn't a question mark there, so I should have understood that you were making a statement instead of asking a question. So, okay. All right. So, and Kyle had mentioned earlier that he likes to take screenshots out of Direct and do it and use those in a separate report. He makes his own report, I guess, not using the report tool in that's built into Direct there.
Sure, yeah. You could obviously do some more visuals and that sort of thing. That could be more powerful.
Right. So Kim mentioned here in modeling, is it important to look at the high frequency phase? So when you're doing a model and you're looking at the higher frequency coverage of the loudspeakers that you're putting in, do you turn on phase or do you leave it off?
I tend to leave it off. I may toggle it on and off depending on what I'm looking at. I mean, the one thing to know, I mean, because a lot of times people go, okay, yeah, phase, look at there's phase, and they see either there's kind of two ends of the scale. You're either going to see very defined curves or lines, right? Okay, that vary in color, or you're going to see, especially on the top end, most of the time what you see is a lot of just pixelized. It's almost like very random looking. That very random looking stuff is, I mean, I would say I'm not going to hear it. Okay. So it's going to be very minimal as far as what your brain can sense that it is. The stuff that you're concerned with is that stuff that is down there at the root note of the comb filtering, what Ivan was talking about a couple weeks ago. And that's that really defined stuff. We tend to see that in the low end, the subwoofer region. We see those, you know, you can have stuff that has a single big lobe. You can have stuff that has, you know, a lobe in the middle and a lobe to either side of it. And then obviously, as you go up in frequency, it's just going to, based on the same spacing, it's going to just continually add more lobes, more lobes, more lobes. And, you know, the more chaotic that gets, it's less noticeable. Yeah, exactly.
So in the higher end, maybe the phase isn't quite as important as it is when you're identifying the initial notches that are created by the comb filtering of multiple sources, basically.
Yes, right. So, I mean, your hope is that on the high end, if you're designing the system correctly, like if we take a mono example, your hope is you're using a product that gives you great pattern control in those, especially in the intelligibility region and higher, and you are putting that sound in the region or the zone of the space that you want it to be. And then what I would look at is, okay, what is my interaction? This is where fills and delay speakers, you know, what is my interaction now with these speakers, with the mains? And they tend to be, if the design is right, they tend to be more in the low mids. And that is where you're going to see, that's where you want that spacing of the devices to really drive that deepest notch of the comb filtering down low So then you implement the high pass above that and you time it. So your idea, or the idea is, you know, let the device do what it's doing, or do what it needs to do to cover the area with the frequencies that are not getting there, because the main PA is more than likely putting 200 hertz pretty much everywhere in the room, right? But it's maybe not putting, you know, 500 hertz and up everywhere. So we need a fill speaker in those left, rights, or back of the room, or wherever it is. We need a speaker to add that back in. But the great thing is, if you use devices that have forward directivity, then you can put that in that area. And again, going back to Ivan's comb filtering class last or 2 weeks ago, the, you know, it's not just where they interact, it's the level, the time of the interaction. So we can, you know, kind of in a way get a pretty good grasp on time with delay, as long as we're leaving the area that we need to average into fairly small. So if we can get a good average over a lot of people, that's good from a time standpoint. But what is that level over there? I mean, heck, if it's 12 dB down, who cares?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. The interference will be minimized.
Yeah.
The more the level is different. To that note, though, it's worth pointing out that for each loudspeaker that's indirect, you can also adjust the delay time and the gain sure. of that loudspeaker. So you can actually do a pretty reasonable job of roughing in some level differences and time differences that will reflect what you may want to do in the actual space to get a specific result.
Yes.
If you're trying to adjust the you know, how that interaction happens in the space.
Yep. And it's great because you can see that, you know, with the virtual microphones, you know, place that in an area that is, you know, in between two devices where the right. levels are going to be of equal, and play with that. And you can see how you can move those notches around.
Right. Yeah. So Bill here also mentioned that lately he's found that changing the SPL color scale in direct to step the display at 6 dB provides a nice confirmation of meeting a plus minus 3 dB within a specific seating area.
Okay. Yeah, and so I think to his point, the other thing that we discussed a couple weeks or a few weeks ago was I always turn on the step feature or the isobar feature, and I tend to set it at a 3 dB increment, just so I know, you know, three colors would be about, you know, a plus or minus three. So that can help out too, because just like anything, if you're looking at an infinite color palette, it's pretty hard to tell, you know, what is what. Now, again, going back to the sales tool, sometimes it's good to know, you know, how is it being displayed from your competitor, right? So
right.
An isobar can be very, you know, not exact, but it can be very defining, right? It's saying this is the transition, this is the transition.
And, well, if you're showing 1 dB differences yes. and they're showing 6 dB differences, of course yep. theirs is going to look better.
Yeah, yeah,
to it's that, smoothing. Yeah, and to that, Ian here mentions that 6 dB increments always look better on the sales pitch.
Yeah. And sometimes no increment can look, you know, can help, you know. You know what I'm saying? I mean, if you look at eases, I mean, that's one of those, you know, it's all pink. Well, okay, but there's actually, if you start looking at it, you go, okay, well, there's actually a little bit, there's more variance than you think out here. You know, it's a tone, red tone to a pink, and in yeah, so it's not deceiving. It's just, what are you doing, right? I mean, what am I getting the electronic microscope out, or am I visually inspecting it with my eyes? You know, I mean, you do have to know
how close do you want to look.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Yep. Absolutely. Yeah. Bill mentions here isobar equals engineering tool.
Yep.
So yeah. All right. Well, cool, guys. I think that pretty well wraps up the questions here, unless somebody's got something else to kick in. So, yeah, I guess with that, we'll go ahead and wrap things up here a little. So I want to be sure to thank Chad for joining us this week, and I want to thank all of you for taking the time to join us. Please be sure to come back next week at 11 a.m. Eastern time, same bat time, same bat channel, and Ivan will be back with us to talk about interpreting spec sheets. So everybody have a great rest of the week. I know Friday's tomorrow already. It seems to sneak up on us every week. And then the weekend after that. So I hope you all have an awesome week next week, and we'll chat with you then.